So the message, the kings of the earth, who are the kings of the earth? And we're going to look at that from three different aspects, and I pray it's going to encourage you and inspire you. But in regard to the kings of the earth, have you ever considered this? Why do men want to rule? Why are people compelled to become dictators, tyrannical? After World War I, Germany was devastated. And the reason Hitler was able to rise to power is he started talking about the German people and about their rightful place in the world. And next thing you know, he's gone completely haywire and tries to take over, not just rebuild the German and the German nation, but take over the whole world. Why? What's the compelling force that drives men, Stalin, Hitler, the king at one point in England, and we can make a long list, Mussolini. What drives men, what force is there that compels men to become rulers of the world? We do know there's coming one who desires to rule the world, and we do know our country is moving toward globalization at record speed. And the next question, though, is probably a little more personal. Why is it that so many people seek a ruler, seek to be ruled? So we're going to investigate that a little this morning in the context of this King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. But I will tell you this, it is time for the true kings of the earth to stand up, to speak up, to reach out, and get ready to go up. Stay with me. I'm going to say that again here in a minute. Be warned. It's time for the true kings of the earth. So we're going to look at this. And the first thing we're going to look at this morning to put it in context, and this is a celebration message about the body of Christ and the King of Kings. Number one, the children of Israel, for some reason, wanted a king. What was the reason? They wanted to be like everybody else. You know, the greatest challenge that we face in our lives is this somehow, this perverted desire to be like everybody else. Now, I just put it in the context back when I was a hippie. You know, we weren't going to conform to this world. We all dropped out. And I looked around, we all looked just the same. In our nonconformity, we all conformed. We do it at church. Maybe you do it at work. We live our Christian lives like chameleons. We have a tendency to adapt to our environment rather than to impact and change our environment. Come on, I'm going to help somebody up in here. Now, in 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 1, we find this first type of a ruler or king is the self-appointed or the people-appointed king. In 1 Samuel chapter 8, verse 1, and just see if this kind of sounds a little bit relevant today. And it came to pass when Samuel was old that he made his sons judges over Israel, and his sons did not walk in his ways, but turned aside after lucre, you know, many people call it filthy lucre, money, gain, and took bribes and perverted judgment. Sounds like America. Sounds like American politics. They turned aside after materialism, they took bribes, and they perverted judgment. This election will come out the way it's supposed to only if judges follow the law. Pretty simple. It's always been pretty simple. Then how can it be so complex? Filthy lucre, bribes, lies, deceit, dishonesty, the desire to rule. Do we not have enough issues in America just take care of America? Do they not have enough trouble overseas just take care of their own nations without trying to dictate to us? It's amazing, this perversion. And where does that come from? From the fall of man. Be fruitful, multiply, replenish the earth, and take dominion. Then the fall of man Man's heart became desperately wicked. Who can know it? The days of Noah, people's hearts were always inclined to wickedness. And then that creation of God and that command of God to take dominion then gets perverted. And we try to take dominion over everybody else. It's a spirit of control. Well, they turned aside after lucre, bribes, and perverted judgment. Then all the elders of Israel gathered themselves together, came to Samuel, and said unto him, behold, you're old. Duh. Don't you hate it when somebody says that to you? I was somewhere, and one of the kids at school said this to me. How'd you get so old? Well, it wasn't planned. I just kept getting up. Y'all laughing. It's going to happen to you. I hope it happens to you. That means you're still with us. He said, you're old and your sons do not walk in your ways. Now make us a king to judge us like other nations. And this displeased Samuel the prophet when they said, give us a king to judge us. And Samuel prayed to the Lord. Thank God for spiritual leaders that pray to God for God's people to make right choices. Thank God they pray that they would make right choices. Or should I say we? And the Lord said to Samuel, hearken unto the voice of the people. Now how many of you know God said, I will supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus? My God will supply all of your needs. That's the scripture. We quote it all the time. Now we don't bother to put it in context of giving, but that'd be another message. No, it might be that today's. But you know, one of the worst things that can ever happen in the lives of most Christians, they'd get what they want when they pray. I pray my God's going to supply my needs. Now, I will say it is Christmas season, and Janet was talking on the phone, I don't know, one of the girls, somebody, and I said, tell them I don't need anything. I don't want anything. I have everything I need, everything I want. There's not one thing I lack. I don't need another tie. Hallelujah. I don't need another suit. Thank you, Jesus. I got my funeral suit and my wedding suit. That's all you need. Well, and of course, then in November, I had my birthday suit. That's an image we don't need right there. I don't need a car. I don't need a house. I don't need another wife. Woo, come on. One's plenty. And then polygamous, come on, get yourself a brain. A wife and two daughters, I'm already outnumbered. As of right now, I'm alone and going home alone. Can I get some help up in here? It's amazing to me that we pray for the things we want rather than like Jesus taught us to pray, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I don't want anything but what God wants for me. So many times we pray, and Samuel prayed for the people. He sought the Lord. And here's what the Lord said. Paraphrase. Give them what they want.
Have you ever considered a Christian education for your child? Then you should check out Arkansas Christian Academy, Saline County's fully accredited premier Christian school at an affordable family rate. Students have opportunities to excel in academics, athletics, fine arts, and technology. And through our dual enrollment program, high school students can even achieve an associate's degree prior to graduation. Visit us at arkansaschristianacademy.org.
You continue reading 1 Samuel chapter 8, and the Lord said, just before we give them what they want, tell them that they're asking for a king because they don't want me to reign over them. They want to be like everybody else, but tell them that they're going to make their daughters, the king will make their daughters bakers and make their sons butlers, and they're going to take 10% of your flocks, they're going to take 10% of your income, and they're going to control you and take advantage of you. But just go ahead and tell them that's what the king will do if they don't want me to reign over them. In other words, I'm going to give them what they want. For they haven't rejected you, Samuel. Now listen to this phrase. They haven't rejected you, but they've rejected me that I wouldn't reign over them. Christians, when we are attacked, put down, endeavored to be controlled, it's really not about you. Don't take it so personal. That's where you get into all kinds of negativity. They are rejecting Jesus. They're rejecting the God that created the heavens and the earth. They're rejecting the God that we will all be held accountable to. Don't take it personal. Don't make it about you and them. If they reject you, I've been rejected by more people that are in this room. I've been rejected by more people live streaming. I've been rejected. I've been put down. But I ain't destroyed, hallelujah. I'm a child of God. So don't get caught up in all the negativity. Now, it's important you pay attention to what you're doing and who you're listening to. So the Lord gives Samuel this word. And he says, go tell the people, this is what's going to happen. If you get what you want, this is what's going to happen. This is how you're going to be treated. See, somehow this generation, and I'm not talking about an age group. I'm talking about this entire generation. We bought into this idea that government is the answer to equality and fairness. If that's true, how has this experiment for 247 years not worked out? And how is this earth experiment that's been going on for 6,000 years, why has it never worked out? Because of the hearts of men is desperately wicked. In the days of Noah, their hearts were inclined to wickedness all the time. That's why it doesn't work out. That's why we cannot put our trust in the kings of the earth or decide to self-appoint our own rulers and kings. I want Jesus to be King of kings and Lord of lords, even in my personal life. Can I get an amen? Can I get an amen? Amen. So he said, listen, they just don't want me to reign over them. Samuel, this is not about you. I know it hurts your feelings. You're the prophet that I've appointed, but this is the way it is. And this is what God says, 1 Samuel 8:18. And you're going to cry out in that day because of your king, which you have chosen. Nevertheless, the people refused to obey the voice of Samuel, and they said, no, we will have us a king over us. What is the compulsion? What's the compulsion? Compulsion, that's Barney Fife. Andy, it's a compulsion. Who is the true king of the earth? Well, here we are. It's the celebration season. It's Christmas. Who is the king of earth? Who is the true king of all kings? Isaiah tells us this. Isaiah 9:6, the God-anointed king. Not people appointed, people chosen. Not self-appointed. Isaiah 9:6 says, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, the government. Everybody say government. Sounds like God's involved in our social affairs, doesn't it? Boy, we pretty much kicked him out of church, and we've done everything we can to kick him out of government. This child that we celebrate in this little red wagon, the government shall be upon his shoulders. And his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Someone came to me today and said, where I work, I am continually berated. They continually, my boss and everyone I work with, continually berates me and says they do not care anything about God, they don't care anything about church, and they do not want to hear anything about Christians. And he said, but something supernatural's happened. And they just ask how they can help my church during the holidays help people. Do you have a card for the ranch that I can give to my boss? Wow. See, we're living in a season and a time that if you get your eyes on the natural, you're going to get frustrated, irritated, anxious, worrisome, down in the mouth. All we ever hear is bad news. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform it. Well, you know, God's in control. God will just work out his will. Let me explain something to you. God is God. His will is going to come to pass. The real question is, are you going to be in on it or not? Because you do have a responsibility. Everybody's not going to go to heaven. You have a responsibility. You have a response. You have accountability. You just can't put it all off on God. God does not go into the booth to vote unless you do. God does not come with you to church unless you bring him with you. He's here with us, but he's only with you if you come with him. He has given us the responsibility to transport His presence and His responsibility in action, faith with corresponding action. He expects us to be a part of the process. But who is this King of glory? Well, Psalms 24:7 says, "Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lifted up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in." Well, who are the kings of the earth, and who is the true king? Well, we know the answer, don't we? Then why does the Bible bother to tell us all this? Because we have to be reminded continually in the midst of the storm and the darkness and the deceit that He is still the King. And He will bring His will to pass. Well, who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty. The Lord mighty in battle. Now, wait a minute. Lord mighty in battle? I thought God's got everything under control. Why is He having to fight? We have law enforcement officers attend here. I spoke for several minutes after first service this morning with a law enforcement officer. Why do we need them? Depends on what state and city you live in. Why do we need them? Because everybody's not honest. Everybody's not kind. Some people steal. Some people rob. Some people rape. Some people murder. The Lord's in a battle. Why? Because there's a natural realm and a supernatural realm. And we have the King of kings and the Lord of glory who's given us a responsibility. And if He's in a battle and we're His children, He's given us armor to fight in this battle. And we fight from a position of victory. But we're in a battle. And in this passage, it tells us the Lord is strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads. Don't get downcast. Lift up your heads, O ye gates. Even lift them up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Well, who is the King of glory? Well, the Lord of hosts. He's the King of glory. We know Him by name. We would refer to Him as Jesus, Yeshua. The other translation would be Joshua, Jesus, or Jehovah God Almighty. We know who this King of glory is.
Hi, I'm Perry Black right here at Second Chance Youth Ranch TV on Victory Television Network. And I'd like to invite you personally to join us every Thursday night at 11 p.m. as we look at the need for fostering, adoption, and mentoring. What a great opportunity you have to join us every Thursday night at 11 p.m. right here on Victory Television Network, and I look forward to seeing you.
So I've been struggling. How do I get this message that I know the Lord gave me to share and get it out here, because we only have about an hour left this morning?
Try not to make eye contact.
Peter and John walk through the gate beautiful in Acts chapter 3, and there's a guy. He has been lame. He's been crippled from birth. He's 40 years old. We know the story. He asked for some help. And they said, "Silver and gold we have none." They took him by the hand and said, "In the name of Jesus, rise up and walk." And immediately the man began to stand, and his feet and ankle bones received strength. And I mean, revival broke out on Solomon's porch. Until the religious people found out. And they called them in and said, "Hey, what are y'all doing? What authority are you doing this?" And so a long story made as short as Perry can. They said, "Listen, we have to do what God called us to do, or we'd obey God or men." So it says they put them in jail. Now, I've read this passage hundreds of times, but for this message, I read it and read it and reread it, and it ultimately, finally, in chapter 4 says, the religious folks could no longer deny that a miracle had taken place because the man that was healed was standing there. Well, this was the next day in chapter 4, and it dawned on me, bing, you ever had one of them? It dawned on me that when they were thrown in prison, it appears, according to Scripture, The man that was healed was thrown in jail too. Is anybody here today willing to go to jail if you're healed? Well, you know, I'm dealing with COVID, and you get prayed for and they throw you in jail. You're dealing with cancer, we pray for you. God heals you, they throw you in jail. You're lost, you're addicted, you're struggling, you're depressed, you're suicidal. We pray for you, you get completely delivered and born again, and they throw you in jail. Any takers in here? Raise your hand. I'm a taker. I'm willing to do whatever because I believe that it's worth serving God. And so listen to this passage. This is what really caught me in my study. And when they were let go, they returned to the other disciples, their company, and reported all that the chief priests and elders had said to them. And when all they that were there heard that, they lifted up their voice to God with one accord and said, Lord, listen to this. This is powerful. Lord, you're God. Boy, that's a mouthful. Which has made the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that is in them. You ever heard the phrase, well, listen, I'll just tell you right now, if you don't do what I want, I'll just take my ball and go home. FYI, God owns the ball you're sitting on. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. The audacity of human beings in a fallen state and sometimes even as a born-again carnal Christian to not want to have God reign in our life every day. And they lifted up their voices. And who by the mouth of your servant David, quoting Old Testament, why did the heathen rage and the people imagine vain things? The kings of the earth stood up. And the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against His Christ. Wait a minute. Is that in the newspaper or is that in the Bible? The kings of the earth stood up and rulers were gathered together against the Lord and His Christ. So who are the real kings of the earth supposed to be? I am so glad you stayed. It's 12:05. Relax and breathe. I'm nearly done. The true kings of the earth are God-appointed kings. Not self-appointed, not people-appointed, but God-appointed. Raise your hand if you're born again. That'd be us. God-appointed true believers with God-given authority. They come back and give the report that we went to jail, and here was their prayer. This should be our prayer. Lord, behold their threatenings. And grant to your servants that with all boldness they may speak the word. Why the word? Because faith comes by hearing the word. But it's not enough to speak the word, church. Listen to me. It's time we walk in this awakening, walk in this renewal, walk in this authority, and walk and live in the supernatural now. He says, Lord, behold their threatenings. They've told us to shut up, to no longer preach in His name. What name? The name of Jesus. And grant to your servants that with boldness we will speak the word, and that you, by stretching forth your hand, you will heal, and that signs and wonders may be done in the name of Jesus. Folks, we need to fall on our faces before God and cry out for God to confirm the word that we speak with signs and miracles and wonders and healings, driving out discouragement and fear and disease and conquering even death. We've got to believe God. And then when they prayed, the place where they were was shaken. Folks, that's an outpouring. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. Wow. Lord God, fill us to the brim, to overflowing with Him. Fill us with your goodness, your dynamite power, that when we pray for people, they'll be healed. Young lady, 31 years old, up in Missouri, had COVID some many weeks ago, seemed to be doing well, suddenly an attack. Someone in the church has a family member there in the medical area ministering to this person. And she said, as a nurse, can I pray for you? And started praying for her, and then contacted family. Family contacted many prayer warriors in this church. With her, the young lady's permission, said, yes, please have people pray for me. She was on all kinds of equipment, plugged in everywhere. I got numerous texts. Doesn't look like she's going to make it. It's going to be a miracle. I've seen people with less symptoms that have died. People all over the world praying for this 31-year-old young lady. She's had a complete turnaround. God's doing a miracle in her life. This friend from this church who's in Springfield said, "Can I pray for you?" She said, "Yes," with tears running down her cheeks. I'm here to tell you, God still answers prayers of people who pray prayers of faith. Stand on the promises. Don't give in and don't give up. And don't get your eyes on the kings of this world. Keep your eyes on the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And realize you have been appointed as a king and a priest unto God. Revelations 1:6. And we have the authority to stand in the gap in the power of God and bring heaven and the resources of heaven into the earth. Revelations tells us that. In Acts 4:13, the religious people saw Peter and John and the disciples and realized they were, quote, ignorant and unlearned. But they recognized something powerful. That these guys that God had used mightily in a miracle healing of this man of 40 years of being paralyzed, they recognized they had been with Jesus. Can it be said about us today that we have been at church, or can it be said we have been with Jesus? This Jesus, Scriptures tell us, is coming of the east. This lightning cometh out of the east and shines even unto the west. So shall the coming of the Son of Man be. Singers, will you come real quick, real quick? Band, come quick. This little baby, so cute and precious, the God baby. 100% God, 100% man, so cute and precious. There's nothing more precious than beautiful, sweet, innocent baby children. But he didn't say, this little baby. He grew to a man who was completely given not to his will, but to the Father's will. We will walk in the supernatural power of God's great awakening when we cry out to God, not my will, but thy will be done. Jesus, King of glory, reign.